Guys, so before I present to you the volume roundtable, I just have two very quick clarifying items that I wanted to get out of the way. The first is that there will be some language in this episode. So if you happen to be listening to this around children or what have you, just be advised that we do drop the F-bomb a couple of times. And secondly, video will be probably required for certain parts of the discussion. So when you get to the part where Greg Nuckols starts talking about and referring to a graph, it might be useful to just note that time. It's about an hour in, and just make sure that you watch the video component of his speaking part, just because I think that without that visual aid, you might not really be able to appreciate the point that he's trying to make quite the same. So for our listeners on iTunes, I will make sure that I put the link to the YouTube video of the discussion in the show notes, and then also for our YouTube listeners, I will have timestamps for all of the discussion topics. So if you want to jump around, or if there's something that you are looking forward to hearing more than the other stuff, then you can just jump right to that, and that will all be in the description box below. So without further ado, I give you guys the volume roundtable. Okay, well, hello everyone, and welcome to the Ice Cream for PRs podcast. My name is Jeff Nippard, and I am your host. And with me, I've got Dr. Mike Israetel, Dr. Layne Norton, Eric Helms, and Greg Nuckols joining me for a conversation about training volume. So for any of you guys who might be new to the podcast, I'd just like to quickly point you guys towards two other episodes that I think you would really enjoy. The first one is episode number 28 with Menno Henselmans, where we really dissect all of the research to do with training frequency. So while this episode will be focused more so towards how much work you should be doing, in that episode we focused on how frequently you should be doing that work within the training week. And I think Menno did a really good job of outlining a specific case for why training at higher frequencies might be a good idea. The other one that I think you guys would enjoy is episode 21, where Eric Helms, Layne Norton, Peter Fitchin, and Menno Henselmans came on to discuss reverse dieting. And not only reverse dieting, but also how it is that competitors should go about approaching the post-show period, and a whole bunch of other stuff just to do with nutrition for contest bodybuilders in general, and scientific principles to do with metabolic adaptation and so on. And then also, if you want to go through the entire backlog of the podcast, there are interviews and roundtable discussions with expert nutritionists, expert coaches, and elite level athletes like Cliff Wilson, Lyle McDonald, Doug Miller, and a bunch of others. So I'm going to get into introducing our guests in just a moment, but first I just want to briefly outline some of the terminology that you guys will be hearing throughout this episode. So the main one will be training volume. Regular listeners will definitely be familiar with this term, but in case anyone isn't quite up to speed, what we'll be using that term to mean, I assume, is basically how much work you're doing. So in the literature, this is often outlined as the total number of sets. So all else being equal, a group doing more sets will be doing more volume. It's also defined as the sets times the reps, or the sets times the reps times the load. So all else being equal, a group doing more load will be doing more volume. So that's basically what that means. And then also you'll be hearing the terms max recoverable volume, which basically means that I think you should be doing as much volume as you can recover from, so as to sort of max out the progress that you can make. And then the other term would be minimum effective dose, which is similar but sort of states that you should do the minimum amount required to make the progress that you want to make, and not necessarily do more. So as for our panel this week, speaking first, we'll have Dr. Mike Israetel. He is a professor of exercise science at Temple University. He has a PhD in sports physiology. He's a competitive bodybuilder, powerlifter, and Brazilian jiu-jitsu grappler. He's also a coach for other bodybuilders and powerlifters, and is the head science consultant at Renaissance Periodization. You can learn more about Mike at renaissanceperiodization.com. And Mike, it's a real pleasure to have you on the show, so welcome.
Excellent. Yeah, no, seriously, thank you very much for having me. Honored to be among such great thinkers in our industry slash field, whatever.
Okay, so
I'm sure other people will have pithier intros. This is just ran. I just ran through all the hurdles on this one. So
that's great. Okay, so we've also got Eric Helms returning to the show for the third time now. So Eric is himself a pro natural bodybuilder, powerlifter. He's got a master's in sports nutrition and exercise sciences. He's currently a PhD candidate. He's published multiple studies in scientific journals. He is a coach at 3D Muscle Journey, and he is the author of two books that I can't possibly recommend enough. You can find them at muscleandstrengthpyramids.com. There's one on training and another one on nutrition. And whether you're a novice to this sort of stuff or you're someone who's veteran in bodybuilding and powerlifting, I think that these books really serve as probably the single best way to sort of conceptualize and categorize all the information that you may have taken in, for example, through these podcasts or elsewhere. So I will put the link to that in the description so you guys can go and get your copy of those. We've also got Dr. Layne Norton returning for another show. Layne is a natural pro bodybuilder. He's a world record holding powerlifter. He is the owner of a supplement line called Carbon. He's got a PhD in nutritional sciences. He's also published multiple studies in scientific journals. He is also the co-founder of Avatar Nutrition, which is an online profile-based flexible dieting service where you're given specific macro guidelines based on your body weight, activity level, goals, and other factors specific to you. So if you're someone who, say, might not be able to afford full-time coaching services from Layne, you can get your macronutrient intake guidelines and continued updates on those as you achieve your goals at avatarnutrition.com. And you can also join Layne's members-only forum for exclusive content from Layne and other science-based professionals at biolayne.com. Welcome back, Layne.
Excellent show job, Chef. I appreciate that.
Oh, it's the pleasure is all mine.
I'm just here for the beer.
Awesome. Okay, so speaking of beer, we've got Greg Nuckols. Greg is a powerlifter and founder of Strength Theory, which is a science-based blog for strength and physique athletes. Greg has an exercise science degree from Harding University, and he also coaches powerlifters and other strength athletes. You can learn more about Greg and the services that he has to offer at strengththeory.com. And as with the rest, I will put the link to all of the websites in the description box on YouTube and in the show notes on iTunes and Stitcher. Which brings me to where you can find this podcast. You guys can find it on iTunes, Stitcher, and on my personal YouTube channel, which is youtube.com/JeffNippard. You'll also find standalone informative videos from me and training vlogs sort of documenting my own journey through bodybuilding and powerlifting on there. And so if you'd like to continue this conversation, you can do so in the comment section on my YouTube channel. You can also reach out to me on Twitter, Instagram, Snapchat, and Facebook. They're all at Jeff Nippard, and I'd love to hear from all of you guys there. And the last thing I will say is that if you guys do want to support the podcast, the best way you can do that right now is just by subscribing in any of the places that I've just mentioned, wherever it is you like to consume your media. Or you can go over to iTunes and leave me a review and a rating as a podcaster. That's actually quite helpful to me. So if you like the work that I'm doing here and the content that I'm putting out, that would be much appreciated. So I guess we'll get right into things. So the podcast question or topic, I should say, is going to be whether physique and strength athletes should train with the maximum volume that they can recover from or the minimum volume needed to make progress. And without further ado, I'll let Dr. Mike Israetel take it over from here.
Thank you very much for giving me the first round here. Is my audio coming in okay?
Perfect.
Okay, cool. So I think I'll take a first stab at my hypothesis at a best answer here. I think it depends on how you define both terms, first of all. So I think it's probably good for us to kind of establish some pretty clear definitions at the front end of MRV and minimum effective dose. So I've seen minimum effective dose defined in two ways, and the two ways in which they're defined are not the same practically. And I'd like to hear from the proponents to make sure we get the clear definition so I can properly sort of front my either way pro-MRV, everyone's wrong, I'm right argument. So the first way I've seen minimum effective dose defined is the minimum amount of stimulus volume, let's say per week or what have you, per unit time to make progress. The second way I've seen it defined is the minimum amount of stimulus or volume or what have you per unit time that is going to result in the progress that you want. And those are two different claims. Which one should we be tackling here, or should I kind of say how MRV relates to both?
The way I set it up was to see the progress that you want, but I take it that's the less controversial, less dichotomous one. So you can maybe do away with the former, and then we can all probably
okay.
be on the same page. And what I really wanted you to do, Mike, is
sort sure.
of introduce your concept and your hypothesis of MRV.
Oh, okay. Ooh. Yeah, so MRV is I guess it's a concept that I sort of formally introduced at some point at a conference last year. Max recoverable volume is the highest amount of volume that somebody can do and still recover from, and via that recovery process still benefit from. It is a kind of conceptual idea. It's an answer to the question of how much training should I do. You can do a little bit of training and barely benefit if you're advanced. A little bit of training actually just slows down how much worse you get. You can do a moderate amount of training and benefit to some extent if you're a beginner intermediate. If you're advanced, that would only maintain your gains. And if you do much more training than that, you can maximize your adaptive rate, rate of gains. So long as you're recovering, that should be occurring. We can get really technical if there's a difference between maximal recovery volume, maximum adaptive volume. We can get into that later if you guys prefer, but it's right around the same amount of work. And so that would be the biggest benefit, hypothetically. And if you exceed your maximum recovery volume, you're providing such a high level of work that you are no longer able to recover adequately from it. You're no longer able to make gains, and you're actually either are stuck in kind of a no man's land where you're working too much and not getting much, or you actually begin to see degradations in performance and degradations in gains. So this concept kind of outlines that there is such a thing as too much, there is such a thing as not enough. For the optimal rate of gains, you need to do just right around somewhere within that amount that you can recover from. Obviously, right below it would be pretty much ideal. So that's MRV, not fantastically complicated, so I'm not going to pat myself on the back for that one. So minimum effective dose definition two, which I think I said secondly, is the minimum amount of work to get the results you want is equivalent to MRV. If you want the best results. So we can just toss that one out, in my view. The minimum effective dose concept one, which is the minimum effective dose to see results, I think definitionally sets itself off to a bad start because it's minimum. If you put in the minimum dose to get the minimum results, you get minimum results. You get results, which is good, but they're going to be minimum. And it's a really difficult uphill battle to argue that versus something that gets hypothetically optimum results. Because then after whatever time frame you compare, 1 week, 2 weeks, 3 months, 4 years of training at minimum effective dose versus max recoverable volume, you're going to see greater benefits, in my view, hypothetically, from max recoverable volume because you are trying to get greater benefits. You're trying to see how much can I do that is the most I can do and still benefit from. And of course, that delineates not doing too much. So in my view, you should find your MRV at any given unit of time, how much you can recover from and after, and there's objective ways to do that, which I can speak to later if necessary. Find out how much you just definitely can't recover from, go under that amount and hit it for a while, and then every now and again push the limits and retest to see if your MRV has gone up or down and adjust it towards circumstances. And that's the way I think for best gains. If you use that minimum effective dose concept, kind of reductio ad absurdum style, you pretty much can, I think, trudge along and maybe you know squat 225 1 year and squat 230 the next year. That's technically progress. It's minimum progress, so maybe you shouldn't alter, your approach. I actually like to favor the second definition of minimum effective dose, which is you should do the minimum to get you the results you want. And I think that really is a good definition because it really kind of puts it in a box to say that, okay, so if you want certain results and they're attainable at a lower volume why the hell would you do any more volume? You risk overreaching, you risk overtraining, you risk chronic injury. You're just pissing away time, breaking yourself down in the gym for no reason at all. And on the other hand, I think it also, that definition of minimum effective dose really kind of brings back to reality that let's say my goal is to become Big Ramy, or Big Ramy, however you pronounce it. You guys know who that is? Like Big Ramy, the world's most gigantic whatever he is. A human is an outdated term for what he is. So, you know, let's say my goal is to become Big Ramy in 5 years. And let's say I had some kind of alien recovery capacity, which was 10 times normal. You know, how much volume would it take me to become him? It would be just an abysmal amount of training volume if I could recover from it. That training volume is higher than my current ability to recover and adapt. So if I use that minimum effective dose concept, it would rule out a Big Ramy result for me, because it would say, well, the volume you want for the results you want is impossible to recover from, thus, sorry, it's not on the cards. And I'd be like, okay, cool. And then I'd say, well, what volume is possible? Maximum recoverable volume, and then I'm getting my best gains that I could hypothetically get, and anywhere, you know, if my goals are kind of not super extreme, I just do the minimum volume I need to get them, and that's great. If my goals are to be the best, do maximum recoverable volume. Anywhere between those works. Anything much higher and you crapper after a while, if you get hurt or just poor results. Anything below that, you know, you're just not training enough to get any kind of results whatsoever. So that's my view summed up.
Okay, awesome. Before we move on, I'll just get you to clarify the term recoverable and what it is you mean by that.
Yeah, so it depending on what context it's used, it can mean several things. Usually recovery, its scientific definition, just means a reestablishment of baseline performance. In a physiological system, a reestablishment of baseline parameters. So you say the cortisol is highly elevated after several weeks of excessive training. Cortisol back to normal means that that particular system has recovered. Let's say you have microfractures in your bone or tendon, ligaments, muscles that have been caused by heavy training. Recovery means those microfractures have receded and are now undetectable. A recovery of strength means you've gotten back to your old strength levels after an overreaching phase. The way I like to use recovery the best in this context, especially in the long term, is recovery means you are able to produce an overload again. So let's say you squat, let's say you're Layne Norton and you've left humanity behind, and you squat 585 for seven or something crazy like that, which all the rest of us just fanboy about, you know, and seven, I got it right, didn't I? Is it seven?
Six.
Oh, well, whatever. What's one extra rep, Layne? Take the compliment. Jeez, okay. So anyway, so you squat 585 for six. And then, you know, when are you recovered? Well, it's technically when you can do at least as good, and overload means a little better. So could we say that the day after Layne is recovered? Absolutely not. With a good taper, maybe a week and a half later, he could be recovered to have an overloading performance relative to that. So recovery, in my view, the best definition to use is, have you sufficiently regained performance to be able to present another overload? So long as we define recovery like that, or even just return to baseline, I think that value of MRV puts us really close to what would be the hypothetical maximum adaptive value. It's a really uphill battle to say, listen, how many sets of bench are you doing this week? And you say, well, yeah, six sets. So do you think you could recover from more? You say, well, yeah, I could. So why aren't you doing more? Don't you want to get better? And you say, well, nah. Well, then who cares? You don't want to get better. It's a, you know, failed discussion to begin with. MRV kind of answers the question of why aren't you doing more? Because if somebody, like, if I'm training at what I think my hypothetical MRV is, and someone's like, so how many sets of squats did you do this week? I say, oh, about 15. Well, why don't you do like 20 sets? I heard there's this cool German volume program. They say, well, it would be above what I could recover from, and thus it would be deleterious to my gains. And if someone said, well, I think you're overtraining. Why don't you do 10 sets of squats? I say, well, you know, I can recover from more than 10 sets. I can benefit from more than 10 sets. So why don't I do that? And I think with proper fatigue management in the session, in the microcycle, in the mesocycle, in the macrocycle, I think that intelligent approach to MRV training does not result in a crazy, crazy risk of injury. And I'll say, again, to anticipate some arguments potentially, is that if we are really going to fear risk of injury enough, we are going to take away our best abilities to train. If you want best results, you have to risk injury somewhat. If it's excessive and it doesn't balance out with sort of net effect, yeah, then it's too much. But I think training just within your MRV and not excessively over it does not present a really high risk of injury. I think it's a good approach to the maximum development of capabilities. If we're talking about recreational fitness in a desire to not maximally develop, then, you know, I have no answers for that. I'm not trained in that capacity very well, and I frankly, it's mildly uninteresting to me.
Right.
Let me know if that makes any sense.
No, that's great, Mike. I really appreciate it. And just to make sure everyone's on the same page, when we use the term MRV, that's just shorthand for max recoverable volume. If that wasn't already obvious. So next I'll let Eric say what he has to say about this topic, and then it'll be on to Layne.
Sweet. First, thanks for introing that, Mike. I think this is one of those nebulous topics where it's very difficult to find out how much training I should be doing. And it might change based on goal. It's highly individual. And we all are after the same thing, the optimal quote-unquote progress. So very important question, and one that I think we've all tried to tackle in different ways. And I think MRV is a very reasonable shot at it. So with that disclaimer, I'm going to say why I disagree slightly. So the concept of MRV to me kind of sounds like there's a bell curve on one side and then a sharp drop on the other, to where as you're doing more and more volume, you get more and more progress. And then once you hit optimal after that, you either just maintain or regress. And I think what the research would show is that there's a bell curve on both sides, that you don't start to, like, if MRV is the amount of volume you can do where you're, you know, not recovering, or you are still recovering. After that, you're not recovering, and you would actually see a regression in strength or a plateau, or only be able to maintain it. We have a little bit of data that suggests, you know, looking at, like, say, an 8 or 10 week block where a group doing, say, a higher level of volume compared to a moderate level of volume, they both progress, but the moderate level volume actually progresses faster. It's not all the research, but it exists. And if you look at strength, I think the kind of linear relationship between volume and strength is less clear than something like, say, hypertrophy. Like, if you look at some of the meta-analysis on hypertrophy, things like Wernbaum or Krieger 2009, there is a more linear relationship with hypertrophy and volume for the most part. However, strength, while it is influenced by hypertrophy, it's not, I would say, it's probably the main component that drives strength. So I think it does depend on what you're talking about. I would say, you know, since progressive overload is still required for hypertrophy, you would probably want to be closer to something resembling Mike's definition of MRV if your only goal is hypertrophy. But if your goal is maximal strength adaptation, I have a feeling that you would probably want to be a little bit behind where that definition would be for that reason, or it would be cycled in, because there is kind of that bell curve response to where you might be doing, let's say, 15 sets and getting X amount of progress. When you do 16, it's not that progress stops. It decreases a little bit as you're kind of training in that haze of overreaching a little bit. Now, there's a lot of different periodization models where you can go to MRV or past it and then taper and hope to get, you know, a better response in training afterwards. But unfortunately, the overreaching and tapering research is very sparse, you know? So I think this is something that warrants a lot more discussion. So my attempt at answering the same question that Mike does, and I think they're both very, very valid because it's not very clear in my opinion, is to take a quote-unquote, you know, research-driven approach to what do we think for most people a reasonable shot at optimal volume would be, right? I typically use meta-analyses based on strength or hypertrophy to kind of give a range in the muscle and strength pyramid. I used the range that seemed to optimize hypertrophy from Wernbaum. And then from there, I talk about how to split up that volume based on what your goals are, either for strength or hypertrophy, et cetera, for intensity. I also like that Mike pointed out that the more advanced you get, you know, a moderate or a small amount of volume will either result in just a slower decay of strength or a maintenance of decay. Because at the advanced level, I do think in some ways the difference between minimum effective dose and quote-unquote MRV changes. They get very close. You know, if you can progress in an advanced level, you're probably doing something right. You simply rarely see big jumps in strength in relatively advanced people unless they've been doing something wrong and totally changed it, go from drug-free to not, et cetera, things like that, change a weight class, you know, something like that. So I'm not that uncomfortable with the concept of do what you need to do to progress and not more in a highly advanced level lifter, because that's probably already a lot of stress on the system in absolute sense. And, you know, injury is very, very important to avoid when you're at a very high level, where an injury is not just, oh, I had to take a few weeks off the gym. It's now I didn't get to go to, you know, nationals or worlds or something like that. Sorry, Layne, that wasn't a shot at you, but I just brought that up. So injury does have a very, very high consequences. But I agree that you can't train in the face of fear of injury all the time. I don't think that's a good psychology to have, especially not for someone who's trying to do really well. So I think I try to approach the same thing. What do I think is optimal volume? I base it off the admittedly limited data we have, put it closer to the lower end of that for the person. And then based on the experience of me as a coach, when I'm coaching someone, I go, okay, what do I think is a reasonable volume for you based on your training age? And then if I think it's too low, or if we're just grinding into the dust, I will adjust from there, because there are big individual differences if you were to go, you know, 1, 2, 3 standard deviations in the mean, right? So I think we're all trying to get at that same thing. You know, Mike and I briefly interacted with this on Facebook, and he said we're both trying to get to the Goldilocks zone, which I like, which I think is a good way of looking at it. It's just different approaches on what might be the best way to get there. But my main beef with MRV is it kind of assumes this gradual raise in volume and then a drop off where progress either stalls or regresses, or it doesn't kind of stay that nice bell curve, which may be the case. I don't know if we have enough data to support that, but I would say that some data does not. And I think that's all I got.
Awesome. Thanks, Eric. So before we move on to Layne, I'll just give Mike a quick second to respond to Eric's concern about the bell-shaped nature of the curve there, especially when it comes to strength, and address his criticisms if you'd like.
Sure. Eric, thanks for your response. Always peep your stuff on social media, man. I'm always...
Thanks, brother.
I stalk you. I'm just going to throw that out there. I've got a plane ticket to New Zealand already. I don't even know where I'm going. I just know you're in New Zealand, and I'm on my way there. And I'll find you one way or another. I have flowers. Hopefully they won't go bad. But anyway, back to the debate. So what's it called? To the statement on strength, I think it's I would be very much in that camp that strength training, because it requires so if you're doing hypertrophy training, your recovery means you can recover enough to pound in more volume, maybe slightly more intensity. Strength requires a high level of performance. Sets of 5, you need to be feeling pretty damn good for sets of 5 versus sets of 12, which you can fucking crank out when you're half dead. And in addition to that, some neural factors that play more of a role in strength probably have recovery curves that are much longer, and they summate much more. So after a couple of weeks of hypertrophy training, you may feel fine. After a couple of weeks of hard strength training, that shit is going to add up. So I think the degree, the amount of volume at which strength begins to decline, that is the maximum recoverable volume for strength qualities, is significantly lower than it is for hypertrophic qualities. And it's actually, if we're on the subject, it's much lower for power qualities than strength, much lower for speed qualities than power, and the lowest for technique qualities. You take a couple of golfers, you put them through a 1-hour bench workout, they won't be able to swing the golf club for about 1 week straight with any proper technique. So I think that when you're training for particular sports and particular phases of training, you have to keep in mind and try to get at the MRV of that particular quality you're training for the most part. So if you're training for strength, your overall training volume must be lower, because that is the only way you're going to recover microcycle to microcycle and actually stay within your strength MRV and that optimal zone of development. If your goal is hypertrophy, then you can do much more and still benefit, and your strength may be a little bit down usually, but it's not a big deal to you because that's not your primary goal in training. And we see this ecologically. If you take a survey of bodybuilder versus powerlifter versus Olympic lifter volumes of training, I mean, bodybuilders out-train everybody, but they're not interested in being peaked for strength or even relatively well-established for strength. So that's my kind of thought on there. I think we're on the same page on that. And in regards to the peak drop-off, I actually sort of caricature my argument of MRV more to that effect to try to anticipate your argument, Eric, funny enough, because I thought that your main thrust was going to be like, look, if you get remotely within these high training volumes, you're just going to fucking die and get hurt, and it's not worth it. So let's stay conservative so that we can really eke out progress and just kind of outlast everybody, which I think there's value to that argument. In reality, I completely agree that it's actually a bell-shaped curve. I think there is a drop-off towards the end of that curve in doing too much where there's not a similar drop off in doing not enough. So not enough, you do just a little bit and you can maintain pretty well. You do plenty, you get your best results. You do just a bit more than plenty and you just kind of get worse rate of gains. You do quite a bit more than that, you start to stall. Quite a bit more than that, you start to recede. The problem is once you enter that area and you pump away in that area for weeks and months, your risk of injury goes like that. So the injury will stop you sooner or later, even if your results are kind of in an otherwise sense bell curve. So I'm totally with you on that. And as a matter of fact, if we go with the idea that the results are more bell curvy than I was currently describing, I think that more powerfully describes the MRV argument or supports it, because then it's okay to flirt with that top end a little and oops, end up on the plus side of it. Oop, I overreached a little, no big deal, because I'm still getting results that are just not optimal. So I think if you track your recovery and track your progress well, you can go above MRV a little bit, below. I would say personally it's a good idea to stay a little bit below, but I think once or twice every now and again, you've got to overreach to find out what is above your MRV, because you may never know. I know people who have done very low volume routines forever because they just assumed they couldn't recover from more. They did more, they just got way more gains. Like people who have experimented with everyday squatting, Bulgarian stuff, they're like, holy shit, I can recover. Like, well, there you go, right? Now, can you do that sustainably? Maybe not, but I think it's worth it. And I think in the end, flirting with that optimal sort of MRV max recoverable volume, I think that's probably the best way for gains. On the more conservative side, I can totally see that argument. Like, look, we don't get better in bodybuilding over a year or two. We get better over 20. Maybe if you just want to undercut, you know your MRV, find it out, and then undercut it by just a little bit, so stay safe. I think that's totally cool. If you want to err on the side of more cautious, I think that comes down to a personal choice. You know, do you win Mr. Olympia next year, or do you win it for years 2, 3, and 4 after, I guess is kind of the question, or maybe something like that. But hopefully that addresses the disparities in our reasoning.
Yeah, I think so. And then just really quickly, Mike, I heard you mention there that something to the effect of if you're recovering, then if your goal is hypertrophy, then you can pound in more volume. What would you say to Eric's idea that we at least have some research showing that it might not necessarily be a good idea to pound in as much volume as you can, where in those studies, moderate might actually be better for hypertrophy?
I think moderate is their MRV in that study.
Right.
I think it's closer to their MRV. I think more is just they can't recover anymore. By definition, they can't recover because you'd probably not even be able to lift. They're not be able to progress as much in their weights. They're not able to overload as much. And they probably, in those studies, report, if they took such reports, report high levels of accumulated fatigue. And I think that that's really, there really is their MRV. I think those kind of studies actually really good support for what my understanding of MRV concept is, which is like, yeah, there is such a thing as too much. And I think that term, some people I've talked to, much less reasonable than Eric and my colleagues here, as soon as they see the term maximum, they're like, you're nuts. Do you want us to just do everything? Like, no. Recoverable. You have to be able to recover from it. And we define recovery in a proper way, it's going to really lead to the maximum adaptations. I think MRV is just as powerful in a different circle, not this one. If I was just debating like bro bodybuilding coaches or something, was everyone they've coached just juiced to the gills, I think it would be a completely different discussion where I'm like, hey fellas, maybe we shouldn't do 150 sets per minute or whatever. And they're like, no, you just don't know what it takes. You just fucking up the juice and you can just get as big as you want. And then those people end up with like 2 torn patellar tendons somehow in a hack squat. And you're like, well, okay, I could have told you that was going to happen, right? So I think MRV is just as much of an argument for doing less as it is for doing more. It's really just as much, what can you recover from? Do that much. And it's an art and a science to try to figure out that number, but I think it's worth constantly trying to figure it out so that we don't look back on a bodybuilding career or strength career and be like, fuck, I could have done more. Fuck, I could have won more. Or looking back and be like, why the fuck did I train that much? I'm getting better gains now training half as much. What the hell did I do wrong? Is it okay to swear, by the way, or is it too late to ask that question?
It's fine.
Okay.
Yeah, I encourage it.
Okay, cool.
I was just gonna let Eric, he put his hand up, so I probably mischaracterized what he said. And so Eric, you can clarify and then we're gonna move on to Layne.
Yeah, just very briefly, I was just mentioning that the study I was referring to was that very clear moderate volume group getting better gains than the higher low group, but the high group still getting gains was actually on strength and weightlifters. It wasn't a hypertrophy study. That's minor. So.
Okay. In terms of hypertrophy, is there any research to suggest that moderate might be better than higher, or are you just extrapolating the strength to the hypertrophy?
Closest thing we got that I've seen is 2007 Wernbaum, which is a not quite meta-analysis systematic review where there was higher rates of hypertrophy in the 40 to 70 rep range versus the higher amount than that. There was still progress. And that's kind of my main point, is that if you're truly using MRV based on either I plateau or I regress, you're going to end up past the optimal range.
Right. Okay. All right. Thank you so much, guys. That was an awesome little back and forth. So, Layne, I'll let you give your two cents on this topic now.
I think this is the most patient I've ever been in a debate.
Yeah. Good job.
So you're going to get 50 cents, not two. So I think this is going to be like the reverse dieting debate where everybody thinks we're going to argue and then we get around and agree on most things. because I think that minimum effective dose and max recoverable minimum effective dose in terms of getting the results you want and max recoverable volume are pretty darn close, because here's why. In order for you to progress, you have to induce adaptation. Adaptation requires stress. And so if you're not stressing the system, you aren't going to induce that adaptation. I'm very much generalizing here, but that tends to be very true, at least based on the research I've seen. And so I think the other thing, and Mike touched on it just briefly, alluded to it, people think, well, here, max recoverable volume or minimum effective dose or how much training should I do? And if you tell them, I'm generalizing again. Let's say four sets of squats. Like, let's say somebody's a rank beginner. Four sets of squats a week. Okay. But a lot of people don't understand that your max recoverable volume from year one to year 10 is going to be drastically different if you're consistent in training. Drastically different. It may be even drastically different month to month. Not as drastic, but it will change. So if I took somebody and I said, hey, let's start you out squatting four times a week. They are not skilled enough to – maybe they could, but most people could not avoid injury because they are simply not skilled enough at that movement to execute it with that frequency and that volume. So I think that these two things end up being darn similar, because if you want to induce adaptation, you've got to stress the system. And if you don't want to get injured, you can't go too crazy with it. And both of these things touch on it. I think it's just verbiage, to be honest. Now that I've, because I honestly, this is going to sound bad, but I don't really pay attention to many other people's stuff because I'm so busy with what I'm doing that I just read the research. And so sorry, Mike, I wasn't real familiar with your stuff, but I would agree with almost everything you said, and I agree with almost everything Eric said. One thing I will say is I don't think there's any research, and if you guys want to correct me on this, demonstrating that we have this idea out there that if you overreach enough, you definitely lose strength. That's absolute. I don't know if there's any research showing that if you overreach chronically that you can actually reduce muscle mass. I don't know that that exists. If somebody knows of something, they can let me know. And one thing I want to point out is I've kind of drawn a little – so in debating these two different forms – I guess I like to say minimum effective dose because of the verbiage it used, because I'd rather somebody be a little bit conservative as opposed to way too aggressive, which our population tends to be way too aggressive. I get this all the time. Layne, what do you think of a squat every day? And then I go to their profile and they're DYEL. You know what I mean? Like, they've just like literally started training and they saw this thing on bodybuilding.com and it's like, no, like just go lift weights. Like, you don't need this. Like, and you're going to get injured, you know? And if by some grace of God you don't get injured, like, you don't need it. And the other thing to understand is what happens once you adapt to that? Like, it may take you years to adapt to that. Once you adapt to that, what are you going to do, squat twice every day? Like, it's going to be really difficult to – it's kind of like the concept I have where I tell people diet on as many calories as you can and still lose weight. So you could make kind of the same argument. So I like the analogy I thought of, because for every give me, there's a gotcha, okay? So like, for example, loading creatine, okay? If you load creatine, you can saturate muscle cells faster. If you don't load creatine, if you just take a maintenance dose, you will eventually saturate muscle cells. Both will get you to the same place. Loading will get you there faster. But there's increased risk of GI discomfort with loading. Most people, that it's not a big risk, but you get increased – some people get increased GI discomfort. So if you're willing to accept that risk, that's fine. So that's how I'm looking at these two debates. Both are going to get you where you want to go. One may take you longer. And I look at – people always ask, what's the genetic limit? What's the first off, you don't know. And if you're asking that question, you'll probably never find out, because most people I find ask that question just don't fucking train very hard, because they're looking for an excuse as to why they shouldn't train hard. I can tell you I've spent this many seconds worrying about my genetic potential in my entire life. I can't change it, so why worry about it? And I believe genetic potential not to be a hard ceiling. I think it's an asymptote. Okay, so you can always make it up until you hit the point of sarcopenia and that sort of thing, or if you don't, assuming you don't get injured, you can always kind of make a little bit more gains. Now, they're going to be disproportionate to the work you're putting in as you get more advanced, but it's just going to become so minimal by the end that you don't notice it. So if we look at an asymptote, okay, can anybody see that? Yay, look at that. It's coming through. So this is what I see as the difference between MRV and minimum effective dose, okay? So if you start out, MRV is going to get you there probably a little bit faster based on that, okay? You're going to plateau a little bit earlier. MED, going to be a little bit slower, get you there a little bit later, okay? Both are going to get you the same place you want to go. Now, I guess I err on the side of MED just because every time you get under the bar, you're risking injury. And I totally agree with Mike that you cannot train fearing injury, especially if you want to be great. Like, people ask me about this all the time because I've had a torn pec, I've had a hip injury, I've had back injuries, I've had two herniated discs in my neck. When I can deadlift right now pretty well. I still can't squat very heavy. But when I go deadlift, I am not thinking about any of those things because I can't. Because if I do, I'm going to suck. Okay? So, and I tell people, it doesn't matter what you do, you are going to get injured at some point in your life. Like when you're 60 and 70, your joints, if you've been inactive, your joints are going to suck. If you've been really active, your joints are going to suck. So you might as well have really, really strong muscles and have your joints suck. So I kind of look at these two debates as it's really just kind of verbiage that we're using. I think they're a lot closer than everybody who's going to tune in for this thinks we are. I usually say minimum effective dose just because I know the population because I've worked with so many of them. And I know if I tell them max on something, I mean, they're going to be – Mike's nodding his head. Even he knows it. You know, like it's. And I'm not saying that's not your fault for defining it that way. That's because people tend to be fucking idiots, to be honest with you. And most, I'm sure most of you as coaches spend your time saying, hey, whoa, like back off. You're not ready for that yet. You know, I get people all the time. They're wanting to squat three times a week and four times a week, and I'm like, but you're crushing it on two. Like you just, I had a gal who set a Canadian squat record, squatting two times a week. I'm like, no, like, let's keep this ace in the hole. And then when you're ready, we'll go to three. And what will happen when she goes to three is initially her performance will probably drop off and then it will come back up. But I think I agree with both Eric and Mike. And it just depends on logistics. And I would just say if you're not sure, err on the side of caution. Because like I said, every time you get under the bar, there's an opportunity to hurt yourself. And yes, you are going to have to overreach at some points if you want to get better. You are going to have to do all that kind of stuff. But if you go in and you've got a tight muscle or, you know, you're not feeling great, and I think this is where I've done a poor job in my career of auto-regulating as opposed to just saying, no, the sheet says, you know, 6x5 at 82.5%. By God, we're doing the 82.5%. But I think there's other people out there that are similar stupid to me. And so I've kind of had to back off that. So I think that I really don't disagree with anything anybody said, and I'm sure I'm probably not going to disagree with anything Greg says, but I guess my verbiage that I prefer to use, is just erring on the side of caution. There's my big unsexy answer.
No, that was great, Layne. One thing that I thought you said that was really interesting was the comparison to, dieting. So it's like when you have dieters who want to cut their calories right to 1,000 calories right away. It's like you should slowly get your way there. Otherwise, what are you going to do at this point to make more progress with your diet? Are you going to drop them lower? It's like you get to a dead end, right?
Right. And the other thing is too is, you know, you listen, you may, whatever that low number is, you may have to get there anyway dieting. Like you may wind up there. But if you don't have to spend all your time there, like don't spend all your time there, right? And so that's kind of the way I look at it with volume. Like, listen, if I could make progress squatting, really good progress squatting twice a week, I mean, I love to squat, but I wouldn't be in there four times a week. You know what I mean? Like, it's just, plus it's the time away, you know, time away from my business, time away from my family. I want to make awesome progress, and I'm willing to do the work. And I think anybody who's seen me train in the gym knows that I love doing the work, but it takes away from other things, and like I said, the injury opportunity. Yeah. Do I think it's like once you go from squatting, I don't know, twice a week to four times a week that your injury risk doubles? No, I don't think that. And I think you become more skilled at the movement, so per actual set, it probably drops. But like I said, every time you get on the bar, it could, like, listen, I hurt my hip. I didn't feel like I did anything that much different than I usually do. I just got a little bit shifted at the bottom, which happens to be a normal squat. But I was using an Olympic bar because I was at the gym out of town. Maybe I was tired. I'd been on a boat the day before. So just one little thing, that was it, right? It takes me out for probably around 6 months to a year, depending on how long it takes me to come back. So I'm probably a little bit more sensitive to that subject just because I am injured currently. But it is something we always need to keep in mind.
Yeah. Yeah, I've heard this idea referred to elsewhere as the volume trap. So it's like guys jump the gun on volume and do these super high volume programs before they've built their way up to it. So I would just, while we're on the topic, ask Mike, if you think it's a concern with the max recoverable volume concept to just jump to your max recoverable volume, and could you possibly be leaving gains on the table by jumping there rather than, you know, like Layne said, sort of like slowly working your way up to maximum recoverable? So that's for you, Mike.
Yeah. Well, I think according to Layne's chart, which I think is largely correct, the answer would be no, because you do get there faster. You get more gains and you've got them earlier. I think that those examples of people jumping the gun are almost always, if you jump to your MRV, it's smooth sailing. You get really great results and not much else. If you jump over your MRV, yeah, you're going to get into some shit, or at least get really cranky joints for a while and not quite progress as you thought you would. So I think that example of people jumping the gun and getting way too ahead of themselves with volume because they want to be like, you know, Ronnie Coleman or something like that, then I think usually they're jumping over their MRV. And a lot of that actually, I think, in the younger folks has to do with psychological burnout as well. You may very well be physiologically recovering, but you just get tired of being in the fucking gym all the time. You want to bang hose or whatever the hell young people do. Fuck what I know about that. But, you know, I've heard of these hoes on social media. But
science book.
Yeah, that's what I did most of my life, so no hose for me. But you know, I think there's something to be said for that. I'll also say this, you know, I really like the idea of, personally, of not giving it your all early, your all, even intelligent, even recoverable all, to kind of milk it through and stay safe. I mean, I've competed in bodybuilding a couple times, sucked total dick at it so far, but maybe I'll get lean one of these days. But I'm really jacked, which is cool. So, you know, I didn't train my arms. I didn't train my biceps, because as a competitive powerlifter, I didn't train my biceps until like maybe 3 years ago or something like that. Like, I just didn't, because they were growing enough and everything else was getting huge. And I was like, you know what, I'll just train them when they're good and ready. And I started, and now they're getting much bigger. I think as a coach for high level folks, you have to have that defensible option for people that come to you and say, all bullshit aside, I want to be the fucking best. You're not going to give them a minimum effective dose program if you don't want them to leave you. Something like Olympic weightlifters, when they're developed in their, usually in the countries that beat the United States, those fuckers are smashed from day one. They find their MRV from day fucking one, well, after they teach them basic technique, and then the rest of the time they're training as hard as they can. They don't train any harder because that would be pointless, unless they're Bulgarian, and then you just leave the team when your hips blow out and they get someone new to replace you. And I'm not sure how things work in China. I think a lot of the lifters are actually robots. We haven't quite figured that out yet. But in any case, you know, I think in programs with high-level sport development, they're pushing you as hard as possible, as much as they can. Why? And hey, Layne, can you do me a favor and pick up your graph that you drew really quick again and point it at the screen? So when you're at that there it is. So when you're at that MRV on the right-hand side, if you're a Chinese weightlifter, you're winning world championships up at the top for maybe 6, 7, 8 years. If you are minimum effective dose, you don't start winning world championships until... Am I still there? Oops. You don't start winning world... Good, we're good, Layne. Thank you so much. we don't start winning world championships until the end of your career. So you kind of peak for a very short time at the end of your career with minimum effective dose, but you get to see gains the entire time. With MRV approach, you get good really quick, and we can see this with Olympic weightlifting. There are like 19-year-olds. Greg would be very familiar with the statistics on this. Like, there are 19-year-olds from Turkey clean and jerking damn near the world record in a bunch of weight classes. How the fuck is this possible? You're 19 years old. They get really good. First of all, they've been training since they were 8 or something like that. They get really, really good really fast, and then they eke out slow progress for a while. For championship athletes, you want to stay in that upper band for as long as you can, and you want to get there sooner. Is that a gamble? Fuck yes. For recreational fitness enthusiasts, is that a good idea to just get up there? Fuck no. But for high-level athletes, I think if you tell them, look, we're milking you out, you're not going to win as much, but you're going to be safer on your way up, they're just going to be like, well, you know what, I'm not really interested in this. I want to be good ASAP, and I want to stay good for as long as I can. I think for them, you have to give the option, at least, of an MRV approach to training. And if someone wants to do more on the minimum effective dose side, I think that's a personal choice. I think the injury trade-offs are just about even within reasonable training. So I think that, yes, you are probably going to expand more, grow more, get better if you train more up till your MRV, but also your injury risk probably goes up at first by not the same amount, but as you get closer to your MRV and certainly over, it goes up by a much higher amount. So I think it tends to cancel itself out, and it becomes a personal trade-off of how much do I want to risk it to be really, really good? Because some of the people that are really, really best, they've risked a fuckload. Some of the shit Layne's done in the gym, I wouldn't fucking ever do that shit because I'm a pussy compared to him. But he's the best, right? And that's no small part because of his work ethic and because he, you know, looks at a deadlift bar that's already bent when it's on the ground and they're like, fuck it, I'm just going to pick that up, right? So I think it's really important to kind of offer whoever individual's coaching that trade-off and say, look, you know, we can push it a little. You might get hurt, but you might also get better. 50-50 chance at some level. Or you could say we can milk it out, do slow and steady, and get good progress that way. I don't think there's a clear beneficial answer. I think it comes down, and I think Eric said this earlier, to a specific situation and what you're trying to work with and goals. I think if your goal is to go to the Olympics and someone says minimum effective dose, that's just not going to work. If your goal is to go to the Olympics, MRV or bust. You might want to flirt with that top end of MRV to see if you're really making sure you're getting all the gains you can, because that shit comes with a date, you know, 2016, 2020 or whatever. If you're not good then, nobody gives a shit how good you're going to get. So I said shit a lot. That's all I had to say.
Awesome, Mike. Thank you. Greg, so I'll give you the chance to...
I'm sorry, Greg. Can I just say like one point?
Sure, but just make sure you don't include the word Oli in that point, as you did in the chat. I'm just saying, like, you lost street cred with every weightlifter. Nah. But it's fine.
I have no street cred. Have you seen my YouTube comments? Savage. So I think that Mike makes a really good point about that. And I guess when I would draw up my graph, I would say that right in here is we're targeting this to be where they're getting into the meat of their career. But you're right. Yes. If we're defining that, you get better. You get there faster. Unless you get injured, as we talked about, you can't be in the gym. But we've talked again, for every gimme, there's a gotcha. So you got to pick what you think is best. So Olympic lifters who are put on very, very high volume to begin with, one of the things that putting them on those sorts of programs does is the genetically inferior people get weeded out really fast because they just get broken. So if you want to know if you're genetically superior or inferior, yes, putting you on just a massive amount of volume to see, hey, let's do it and see what they can handle. I've observed, obviously not the same thing, but I work with a lot of females, especially bikini competitors, who have been on terrible, terrible, terrible coaching. And some of them have come back and been fine. Their metabolisms come back to normal. They are able to lose body weight on normal amount of calories, all that kind of stuff. And others of them are tanked for pretty much years, if not life. I can't say life for sure, because usually after not getting results with me, they just stop working with me because it's so long to recover this. So, I mean, I know those are two different things, but I think that's something to point out, is sometimes it's not the so much volume causing that. It's just that it's selecting. Yeah. Fuck you, Eric. It's selecting for individuals who are genetically superior. So Eric's typing, being a smart ass. That's why I'm yes, I really interrupted to talk about bikini. whatever. They need volume two, Eric.
All right, I didn't type anything. I don't know what you're talking about. That's cruel to say that.
Am I on? Okay, sorry. Didn't hear anything. Okay, so I've been making some doodles because I think visually and I think in math. So I'm just curious. Everyone just turn the microphones back on. And is this big enough for you guys to see the numbers on it? So basically at 0.0, you're not doing shit. No one's advocating for that. At 0.1, yeah, 0.1, bad stuff is still happening. You're getting to the level where it's actually some sort of reasonable stimulus. 0.2, I think, would kind of be the caricatured version of minimum effective dose that Eric would argue against, that slightly more than 0.2 would get you some slight progress, but not really anything to write home about. But anything past that point is going to be progress. Also, this on top would be marginal gains or marginal losses, and then the integral of it would be on the bottom, so area under the curve. Then at 0.3 or so, you could probably continue still making more gains, but that is going to be enough volume for progress. At 0.4, I think that's what Mike is getting at for maximum recoverable volume. You get the entire part of the curve that's above the curve, so when you integrate it, the area under the curve is as high as possible. And then when you get further, so when you get to 0.5, things start dropping off a little bit. So you're still recovering from it, you're still making progress, but it's not quite as fast of progress as you could be making if you would have stopped at 0.4 instead. So I'm just curious if that kind of clears up the entire discussion right there, where maximum recoverable volume, that feels like it sort of has the implication that you would keep pushing past where it dropped below the x-axis again, maybe like to 0.5, to where marginal gains for additional volume are actually negative, but you can still recover from it and still make progress. Versus something like 0.4, which is right where that marginal gains curve intersects the x-axis, which is as much progress as you could possibly make. Just listening to both Mike and Eric, that sounds like what both of you are kind of getting at. And just with the terminology used, when you use minimum effective dose, it sounds something more like slightly beyond this 0.2, where you're barely making any progress at all. And with maximum recoverable volume, it sounds like you're pushing past that 0.4, kind of, you can still recover more, but you're getting to the point where marginal benefits of increased volume are starting to become negative, but you can still recover, which I think is what Eric was getting at and is definitely what I was getting at with those two studies comparing low, moderate, and high volume, where moderate won out. But people on the high volume routines, they did still continue getting stronger. They, to use your definition of recovery, Mike, they were still able to present an overload because they did continue getting stronger over the course of the study. But one of the phrases you used is they weren't able to present as much of an overload because they were accumulating fatigue, which I think kind of speaks to the idea of you can recover from more volume than maybe is maximally beneficial. But I don't think anyone is really advocating for that. So that would kind of go against the caricatured version of MRV. And I think that, again, the definition of minimum effective dose is also caricatured from time to time. I actually think, not to pick on you, I think you've actually done this in a Facebook status once or twice, Mike, where you said people shouldn't do minimum effective dose because if you're doing the minimum, then you're making minimum gains. And I don't think that's what Eric is advocating for either. So with kind of that picture in mind, I'm just curious if that kind of clears up a lot of the maybe like questions, concerns, differences in opinion that it seems like just with the names of the definitions that maybe minimum effective dose would be maybe somewhere around 0.3. Maybe you could still do a little bit more, but somewhere in this 3 to 4 area. And MRV would be trying to make sure you're right there at 0.4 as much as possible. Am I kind of on the right track with this?
Greg, on that graph, just so I'm clear, it looks like at the max recoverable volume, there was less gains than a little bit earlier on in it, right?
Okay, so here I think...
It's integrated.
So if you look at the integral, so this would be marginal, and this would be... So this would be how many extra gains you made for each additional unit of volume, and this would be the total amount of progress you made. So here at 0.4, this is the biggest bar. This is just like the area below the x-axis here and the entire area above the x-axis and none of the additional area below the x-axis. So I think that that's what Mike is getting at for maximum recoverable volume, and I think that somewhere around there or maybe there, so around 0.3, would be what Eric is getting at for minimum effective dose. I'm sorry, Eric, I am terrible with terminology, so if you want it to be explained more clearly, if you could do that, that would be great. I'm not the most effective communicator, but by God, I try.
Okay, Greg, that was awesome. I'll just clarify what I was confused about. On your graph, I couldn't really pick out the numbers, and the bottom graph is shifted to the left. So I thought the x-axes were lining up, but they don't. So anyway, it's fine. I totally understand the point that you were making there. Eric, you can go ahead.
Just because my brain at first saw it the wrong way as well, and I actually understood what you were saying. So just to make sure for the audience, the bar graph on the bottom summated. Say again.
Hold it up while you're explaining it.
Yeah. Thank you. Good call. So the bar graph at the bottom is the summated area under the curve above the line minus the curve below the line. That's why 5 on the line graph is below the curve, but 5 is still a positive number on the bar because it's everything that's under from 1.1 to 0.4 minus 0.5. So that just kind of helps people understand that, yeah, you're still progressing even though you're not fully recovered because you've gotten all the benefits of the previous volume, and now you're getting some marginal decrements from that 0.5 amount of volume.
Yeah. So I guess I would just ask Mike, what do you think of the idea of are you really saying max fully recoverable volume, or is it, because like they just said, you know, you can still make progress even though you're not necessarily fully recovered. So would you adjust the terminology based on that feedback, or did that categorize it correctly?
I think it categorized it very well. I think this is now starting to get into a very technical discussion of what the difference is per any unit time between maximum recoverable and maximum adaptive volume. Really, I have no interest in the maximum recoverable volume outside of its ability to proxy the maximum adaptive volume, which is a very easy self-defining term. The most volume you can do and still adapt maximally to, and if you start to adapt worse and still get gains, we're not really interested in that. That's too much. I think most of the time when I'm talking about MRV, when people ask me about MRV, they ask me on a microcycle to microcycle recovery basis, so a sort of microcycle time scale. And in that time scale, so the way most mesocycles are designed is that you accumulate volume load to your MRV and usually just past it with an overreaching phase, and you take a deload phase. And after the deload, you have recovered certain systems, and now you're able to present another mesocycle of overload. I think for that, the maximum adaptive volume and the max recoverable volume are very close to each other. I think, on the other hand, that every on the microcycle level, I think the MRV and MAV are very close to each other. So that would be points 4 and 3 on Greg's graph would be pretty close to identical in that regard on that time scale. On a longer time scale over the mesocycle, you can't crank at your microcycle average volume for an entire mesocycle because you will accumulate fatigue in systems that don't drop fatigue very quickly. So you need a program deloading in order to lower that fatigue and produce another overloading mesocycle. At that point, your average volume load for the mesocycle will now be at your MAV, which is lower than your MRV. But it's still important to have your MRV because that's how hard you're going to train during accumulation, to be very technical. So the MAV is the accumulation plus deload average volume. The MRV is just the accumulation average volume. If we look at a macrocycle, that total volume, because we're integrating active rest phases and tensional low volume phases to drop fatigue, that total volume is now going to be much lower. The MRV for macrocycle is, did you fully recover to have another great year of training? That's going to be an even lower average number because it has to integrate with it those low volume phases. Now it's going to be considerably below the weekly average MRV. So most of the Facebook questions that I fielded, most of the discussion of MRV, that 20 sets per body part shit that I say all the time, that's for microcycle to microcycle on an accumulation phase where you should be chasing overreaching, which means you should be chasing MRV. In those studies in which they did too much and still got gains, I think it was an elongated period of training without proper deloading. And it's very good for a study, but I wouldn't train like that in the real world. You know, you guys, Eric knows all about, they got studies of 12 weeks of progressive overload. Who the fuck does that? Most of us would die, right? But luckily, these people are relatively new to training. They're resilient, and they just get slightly worse results. If they deloaded those people, they would get great results. But now that deload brings down the volume averages to the MAV away from the MRV. But in a microcycle, MRV is what you shoot for. The MRV needs to be defined differently from mesocycle to mesocycle. Can you recover over a month's time in those systems? Then that starts to look a whole lot like that per week maximum adaptive volume on average. And then over the year, of course, your volume drops even lower. I think as you scale out the timescales, your MRV and MAV start to look exactly the same. But at any one particular time, your MRV is going to be much higher in the shorter timescales of training, then your MRV is going to be much higher than your MAV. For example, if we were going to say, well, how sustainable is, what is your MRV per session? Okay, your session-to-session MRV is how much can you beat yourself up in one session and still come back in another session, maybe a different body part, and still present an overload. It's fucking massive. Your MRV is insanely high because you can still, like, how much can you squat so that you can't even bench later? I mean, you'd have to squat your fucking legs off. That is such a high level. It's nowhere close to the microcycle-to-microcycle MRV and way off the meso-to-meso. It is not a sustainable form of training. So I think if you're interested in sustainable forms of training, you should use your accumulation phases at MRV, but your MRV as defined for a mesocycle needs to be lower because you're going to have those deload phases. In the end, it ends up being the same number. So I think if you take Eric's approach and my approach and you integrate all of that together with proper deloading and active rest, the yearly average volume is probably going to be about the same. But what the reason I push MRV is I say, look, within an accumulation phase, you got to fucking work hard. And yeah, you should barely just be able to recover. And there's lots of good data on this, that if you are getting people, here's a common question I get. I'm not getting stronger week to week. Am I training wrong? If you're getting stronger week to week, you're under training because you're obviously not supplying enough fatigue to have any kind of create any, you're not overloading properly. You should week to week within a mesocycle, you should only be recovering your strength. Once you deload, your strength skyrockets, you're at a new level, and then you begin another mesocycle of strength constancy or maybe even slight decrement, and then you deload again and so on and so forth. So I think MAV, maximal adaptive volume, MRV, in the long term, they're the same number, but in the short term, you have to overreach in a sense over your maximum adaptive volume in the short term, and that's where MRV comes in handy.
Eric, I'll give you a chance to reply.
Cool. Yeah, I think you know what it really comes down to is the application and what the lifter actually does. And I guess my main concern is that the lifter doesn't really have any way to differentiate between 0.4 and 0.5. If we're defining MRV based on whether you regress or you can't progress, if you're just maintaining or just barely able to present an overload, they would be able to at a few of those time points. So I think when we've got essentially an error bar that is greater than our ability to detect, I tend to be slightly more conservative and wanting to be more kind of in that center of that bell curve. And I think one thing that when Mike and I discussed this on Facebook, which I actually don't think was even seen by anybody, I think it was like us talking. When I talked about it to him, and he kind of said, "Hey, well, how do you define recoverable volume?" And then in my book, I use a subjective term. I'm like, do you feel recovered and are you progressing or not? And, you know, from the scientist in me, that I immediately rail against that. Like, no, you can't do just how you feel. You're going to do all kinds of crazy stuff. But for a relatively experienced athlete, and especially we know that one of the most predictive factors for overtraining is staleness, or is how you feel. If you can be objective about that subjective determination, and especially, you know, in the research, obviously, it's not just how do you feel, it's use a DALDA or a POMS or a 1 to 10 scale or something like that. I think there we need to give some kind of ability to the lifter to gauge recovery besides just can I provide an overload or not in the gym, because that could be numerous time points there. So I don't know. I guess what I'm worried about is that we're getting very, very technical, but the listener who's a weightlifter goes, right, so how much do I do? You know, and how do I tell when I'm doing too much? I guess that's my concern. Mm-hmm. That's all.
Great. So I know that Layne is on a bit of a tight schedule, so I did want to take some listener questions. So I can direct the first question about rest periods to you, and whenever you need to go, you can, yeah, to you, Layne, and you can just comment in the comment section that you need to step out. All right, so I'm going to take a couple questions from my Facebook page. If you guys do have any questions that you'd like to have answered on future podcasts, you can follow me on Facebook. Like I said, you can also follow me on Instagram, Twitter, and Snapchat at Jeff Nippard. So the first question I'm going to take here is from Kenny Ellison. And he says that it's been proposed that volume is one of the key factors for growth. At the same time, it's been proposed that longer rest periods result in better recovery between sets, hence more weight on the bar, also result in better results. But given that the workout can't last forever, shorter rest periods will be a way to pack in more volume per workout. So what is your take on finding the sweet spot between shorter rest periods to reach more volume and longer rest periods to put more weight on the bar? So I'll start with
what what do you value more? I mean, you can pack in more volume with shorter rest periods. You're going to be using more metabolic stress and less weight on the bar, but you can still, I mean, volume is part of the component of volume is reps. So you can still pack in more volume. If you're a power lifter, probably not the best thing to do, because you're not hitting that specific skill if you're just doing a bunch of reps. I had this question one time. Somebody said they were somebody who wanted to be strong and hypertrophy, and they said, listen, I've only really got 45 minutes to train, what should I do? And I said, honestly, I'd work up to a top set of a conservative max single, and then I would do a set of as many sets of 10 as you can fit in after that, and you know, do it that way, because at least then you're hitting something that's going to get you a strength adaptation, and you're also getting in some volume. But Mike's shaking his head. Yeah, I mean, it's just going to be really, really hard to get really, really strong and really, really big doing it that way. You know, so I don't really have preferences, I guess. My personal preference is I hate not lifting heavy. So I would rather lift longer and get heavy work in, because that's just the way I like to train. I don't think you can really look through the literature and say it's better to rest longer because you put more weight on the bar as opposed to getting the same amount of volume going quickly. I think that resting more enables you to put more weight on the bar, which is more overload, but then again, resting shorter and allows you to put more reps in a shorter period of time. So it depends on what you value more. Is it per unit time, or is it total volume? Okay. So if you're somebody who's very time limited, then you probably need to utilize shorter rest periods. Duh. You're going to do that just by mass effect. But if you're somebody who you don't have to worry about the clock as much and you really love to train heavy like me, then train that way. That's my libertarian answer is do whatever the fuck you want.
But okay. So let's just say that we have someone who has 1 hour.
Boom!
But let's just say we have someone who only has 1 hour to train, and let's just say that they want the most hypertrophy that they can get. Should they prioritize cramming in more volume and shortening their rest periods, or should they lengthen their rest periods for the sake of strength? Eric, I saw you put your hand up, so you can butt in if you want.
Yeah, I butt in. I love it. Sorry. I think the one thing that we should put out there, we've been talking about volume so much, and between the five of us, we understand that not all volume is created equal, but I don't know if the listeners understand that. So obviously, not obviously, maybe not. Not all volume is created equal. If you were to get all of your volume in with, say, 20% of 1RM, that would be a different stimulus than getting it all in at 90% of 1RM. And that's even true if we bring those two numbers closer together. So volume at a higher percentage of 1RM max is going to be harder to recover from. It's going to have stress on other systems. And then, you know, volume at a very low percentage of 1RM, especially if you're not taking those sets near to failure, is not going to provide nearly the stimulus that you would get initially from word go with the higher percentage of 1RM as well. So I just want to put it out there to the listener that if you go too far to the extreme, some wacky stuff starts happening, and it's not all just about volume. And it's important to consider how rest periods interact with load and the time to recover needed and the stress incurred from that. And I think in many ways we should be talking about max recover, not just max recoverable volume, but max recoverable training stress. Because it would be different levels of volume with different intensities.
All right, guys, with that, we're going to take a short break from the show, and we'll be back with some more viewer questions, and we'll let the three remaining panelists hash it out a little bit more. So I'll just pose this question to anyone who wants to take it. But is there a practical way to measure where your maximum recoverable volume is or where it is that we should be putting ourselves in terms of how much volume we should be doing? So I'll let you take it first, Mike.
Sure, thanks. I think at a very technical level within the mesocycle, most properly constructed mesocycle at a 3-to-1 to 5-to-1 accumulation to deload paradigm, I think should be seeking in the last week of the mesocycle to overreach their MRV, and I think there's some good literature to support that that's probably a good idea. And the very case, so you up the volume through the mesocycle or through the accumulation phase of microcycle. Each microcycle increases volume. Then there should be a dedicated phase for deloading. And I think if I'll put it this way, if you are making really big gains in strength, like if you feel much better microcycle to microcycle to microcycle, you are under training. You are not overloading enough because you're obviously not accumulating any fatigue. Fatigue is supposed to accumulate over the course of the accumulation phase of the microcycle. That's how you know you're providing an overload. So if you're really just, you know, you did week one and you're like, I feel fucking great. You did week two and you're like, I'm not fatigued at all. You did week three, you're like, I can do this forever. Well, if you can do it forever, it's probably not overloading. Mistake one. Mistake two is on week number two, you're crawling into the gym and you can barely do everything that you're supposed to or not even. Like week one, you're like Ronnie Coleman's XXXXL program. I'm going to fucking do 80 trillion sets of everything. And then you can't make a recovery for the second microcycle. How the fuck are you supposed to present a continual progressive overload for the next four microcycles or whatever if you beat yourself up way too soon? So that's way past MRV, way past minimum effective dose, way past anything we're talking about. I think Eric and I probably agree on where you should structure most of your week-to-week training. We could tackle the long-term stuff, but it's going to – I think this gets really highly technical. We got to sit down and define terms. Week-to-week, I think we'll see if he agrees with this, but I think a good way to go about it is, do you feel pretty beat up? But do you feel okay enough to still get really good hard workouts in and make some fucking good gains? If you're really not beat up at all, fucking train more. And if you're really fucked up, you're fucking up and you won't be able to sustain that even. So imagine if you do use deloads. If you have to switch to a 2-to-1 paradigm because after every 2 weeks you're so fucked up you need to deload, you've just cut 1/3 of your training year out. You spend it deloading. If you have a 12-week accumulation phase, what can we possibly say about the overloading characteristics of the first 6 weeks? I mean, if you go like this for 12 weeks, the first 6 weeks are probably not even overloading. They're not challenging systems. For beginners, they might be, but for intermediate and advanced, you're just pissing away time. So I think that anything with between 3-to-1 and sort of 5-to-1 accumulation dealer paradigm, where every single accumulation microcycle feels pretty fucking hard, but you can still come back and hit it really well, I think that's within that Goldilocks zone. Towards the end of your accumulation phase, the last microcycle, before deload, you should not feel like you can do another good microcycle, because if you can, you should. It should be designed that in deloads, you should have to need them. Not like you're going to die, but like, well, holy fuck, I'm glad the deload's coming up. Otherwise, I think you're doing some things wrong. I think we can come together on this, is just avoid extremes in training. And I'll weave this into the conversation really quick. Avoid bullshit fucking fads. There's always going to be some people, and I miscaricatured. Now, mind you, Eric, my apologies for miscaricaturing minimum effective dose. I never read anything you had to say about it, unfortunately, and I never attributed it to you. It was like people online, and like I think I read a little bit about Lyle McDonald, his stuff, and if you've ever seen any Lyle's routines, I think they're really underdosed in volume, very respectfully. I think Lyle probably is smarter than me and knows a lot of shit, but like the kind of stuff he recommends, you're like, fuck, I mean, that's really just not that much. So maybe I think the people who are really trying to push that really minimum argument, they took the stuff Lyle was recommending at the very lowest of the stuff he was recommending and were like, well, Lyle says this, what do you think about this? And I just think that's not enough. So I think, like, you know, bullshit fads of people are like, you know, what is it like? People say, oh, like high intensity training, right? HIT, when people are like one set to failure, once every 5 years, you fucking need 5 years to recover, bro. Like, or you whatever, like once a week, right? That's all very likely not going to be overloading and very within your MRV, MAV, whatever. On the other hand, if you're like going to do a grinder program with just totally insane sets and reps designed by drugged up bodybuilders for drugged up bodybuilders, and you're a natural bodybuilder and you're strong enough to really do some damage, it's going to shit you out the other end. You'll have to deload in 2 weeks. I think both approaches and fads that try to say you could do forever work or you don't have to do hardly any work and you get gains, I don't think it works like that. I think that middle ground of doing just enough that you can still recover, make good progress, I think that really is where we can come together, but potentially. And rant.
Yeah. I think I actually did an interview with Lyle, and we did touch on this. And he made the point that if you go up to your max recoverable volume, then what do you do? It's like the end now what?
I can answer that. The answer is periodization. You deload. You take intentionally low volume phases where you define recovery as the recovery of systems you haven't so far. Because the problem with what, you know, that caricatures the training process as the answer for progress is only ever more volume. The exercise selection can be rotated. Different goals can be chosen. You can let some systems recover while you push other systems. Instead of adding more sets to your bench all the time, put your bench on the back burner for a couple of months and work on your squat a lot. Then you can come back to your bench. You have to push the limits regularly in training. You can't save yourself for that one big great workout at the end of your career upon which you retire. I think that's a mischaracterization of my views. I think it's a mischaracterization of training process. So the question is, what do you do when you've done all the volume you can? You fucking deload. That's what you do. That's what they're designed for. And if you're really fucked up, you take an active rest phase and you get back to climbing up that volume tree and you do it all over again. That's training.
Yeah, sure.
No, I agree entirely. And I think that kind of that idea of the volume trap, I think it's overly simplistic in that the only thing it's really accounting for is the stimulus. So you need more and more and more stimulus. And at some point, you just can't handle more stimulus. But obviously, there's another factor as well. There's how well you respond to that stimulus, and that's dynamic as well. So like Mike is getting at, you know, if you've been pushing the volume for a long time, your responsiveness to any given level of stimulus has probably dropped off considerably. So, you know, if you're not really changing any other training variables, the only answer is more. And that can get, you know, that can obviously get incredibly unwieldy pretty quickly. But as long as you're changing training variables, and as long as you're taking deloads, deloads can probably restore some global responsiveness to training. If you're changing, say, the intensity range you're training in, so if you have like a block periodization set up and you're working from a higher volume but lower intensity accumulation block up to eventually a fairly low volume but high intensity realization block, you may not be at the end of that realization block, you may not be super responsive to additional high intensity stimuli anymore because that's what you were just doing. But then when you go back to an accumulation block, you may not have to really be handling that much more volume than your previous accumulation block because that higher volume, lower intensity stimulus, you've probably built back up some responsiveness to that. So responsiveness is to training is also a very dynamic characteristic. And the longer you stick with one given set of training variables, the more it's probably going to drop off. But just by properly periodizing your training, I think you can largely account for that, and have responsiveness to various stimuli go back up, you know, and then focus on those things you're more responsive to. As you become less responsive to them, move on to something else, and, you know, keep rolling like that.
Right. Yeah, I think that's an awesome point, Greg. And while you're here with your mic on, I'll get you to answer the question of how it is we should go about actually measuring this volume. Is it a variable that you need to track, and is that different between powerlifters and bodybuilders? So I'll let Greg start, and then maybe I'll go on to Eric if his opinion on it differs.
The way that I typically track volume for my clients and have people track volume is I just kind of split it up into kind of light training, more like moderate traditional training, and then heavy training. So I'm tracking the number of sets people are doing week to week with sub 60%, with about 65 to 85%, and then above 85%. And then just essentially see, are people recovering well? Are they progressing? And, you know, if I throw a lot more, like, let's say the high intensity work goes up a little bit and they're suddenly, you know, regressing or just not recovering well at all, then that's probably something that's just beating the shit out of them and probably not something that their program should really be focused quite as much on right now. And I know that if I add more high intensity stuff, I probably need to take away a disproportionate amount of sets in one of those other intensity zones. So that's the biggest way I track volume, just kind of splitting up light, moderate, and heavy training, and just counting the number of sets week to week and see, you know, essentially what people are responding the best to, and then also what's causing them the most issues with recovery.
And Eric?
Yeah, similar concept, and I think what Greg is doing is he's acknowledging that not all volume is created equal, like I said before, which I think is really important. And, you know, to go back to what Mike said about how, you know, it should probably be getting harder before the deload, that doesn't necessarily have to come from tonnage or even reps or sets going up. Like, I would say almost your stress should be going up. So a frequent way I'll program is it might be a descending rep scheme, but an increasing, so it's like a linear periodization within a block, and then the deload comes after they're at slightly lower tonnage, but at a higher intensity, and the overall stress experienced is a lot higher, and then the deload comes. So it's kind of melding linear with block, and I also do different reps on different days, so I integrate a lot of periodization concepts. But anyway, I also look at, sometimes I'll look at total tonnage within a block, comparing it to itself. Like if they're only doing six reps and lower, I think looking at tonnage is pretty valuable, because then you could say for the most part that's all in a relatively similar intensity band. When I've got a bodybuilder doing a lot of reps in like the six plus range, I'll just look at reps sometimes. I think that's an easier way to do it versus tonnage, especially if there's more exercises you're playing with, and I kind of look at reps per body part. But yeah, I think so long as your method somehow acknowledges the fact that volume at different intensities is different stresses and differently effective, then I think you're fine. Because there's not a golden rule. There's not a way to do this. I don't think we have or will ever have research that says, nah, this is the way to differentiate between the volume that is most effective or most isn't. I mean, some of the ways I can think of that might get us closer are not practical. Like, if you could track the impulse of a session, maybe, but, you know, how would you, you know, and outside of the lab. So things like that are, it's difficult. There is definitely a disconnect between the practical and the research. And I do the best I can to blend them. I think we're all trying to, but there's always going to be a slight disconnect. And to go back to one other thing before I stop monologuing, Lyle, I think, does something I really like in that what he knows to be true about research and how he thinks people are going to perceive it when he puts it out there, he pays a lot of attention to the latter. So for example, because he's predominantly a diet guy and he's always presenting training almost in the context of someone doing a diet, he tends to err on the minimum effective dose of what is in the bell curve of good, I guess would probably be the way I'd characterize him. And we've had arguments about this too. I communicate with him on a regular basis because we're working on some books together that are primarily his. Mic drop, name drop. But the point is that he'll sometimes criticize me for being a little too aggressive, and then he'll go, right, you can do that because you are a coach. You're making the changes. This isn't someone just reading your book and then implementing it themselves and totally fucking it up, you know? And so now that I've actually written a book and I'm a coach, I've started to learn, man, I need two different voices. You know, I need what I might do on a regular basis or when I'm talking about how I operate as a coach, as education to trainers, versus you're going to self-coach yourself. Here's the tools I'm going to give you. And my programs are a little more simplified. They're a little more clear cut. They're a little less nuanced. And they're probably a little more conservative just because I know how I thought when I was 23 or 21 when I first started training. And it was either natural Olympia or bust kind of thing. And it resulted in a lot of busts, you know. Mm-hmm. So I do think the messaging is very important. And I think probably that's why it seems like in certain conversations I'm on a different page than someone else when we're probably more similar in our actual understandings of the concepts.
Awesome. So I'll direct this one towards Mike. People might want to know, so how is it that I can structure my training so as to be somewhere close to my max recoverable volume? So say pin down a specific number that people can walk away with, if that's even possible.
Depends on the goal, but I think most of the people are interested in hypertrophy. That are asking this question, I think from my experience and coaching myself and coaching lots of clients and integrating that with an understanding of the literature, I think about 20 hard sets. Thank you, Greg, for that concept. I use it all the time. I was going to put out a tonnage number, but that would confuse the fuck out of everyone, including myself. Plus machine transfer doesn't really work well. Hey, I like did 80 sets of calves with 600 pounds. I'm not sore, but I got all my tonnage in for the week. I'm like, oh, great, your arms will grow. But I think that 20 working sets per week per main body part, and you can get very technical as to how you define all that, is probably the average MRV I've seen for intermediate lifters that are drug-free as well as intermediate lifters should be. I think that number is a little lower for very beginner groups, and I think that's one of the reasons why you see that reflected in the literature. Mostly literature deals with beginners. What they term intermediates is actually pretty much beginners as far as we term it. So I think intermediates have built up quite a bit of work capacity, and they can survive and benefit from upwards of around 20 sets per main body part, like, you know, so that pulling in of the back, how many you know, quads, triceps, chest can handle an average of 20 working sets per week, which if you think it sounds a lot, if you're used to bro splitting, which is fucking stupid anyway and you shouldn't be doing, 20 sets of chest sounds like a lot, but if you split it up over a more intelligent program, then maybe that's like 3 days a week you do 7 sets of pushing movements, like 4 sets of bench and 3 sets of fly / incline press. It's really not that, you know, it's not fucking anything to write home about. Some people get overwhelmed with how many body parts they need to hit. And luckily we use compound movements that counts towards multiple body parts at the same time, or at least partially. You know, I'd say benching counts a third to your tricep MRV for set numbers or something like that. So I think 20 is a good number. I would start at 15 and for most people and see how you do. And if you do okay and you're recovering, your strength is able to maintain through an accumulation phase of a metacycle, that's how I formally define it, then I think you're good to go. If your strength is going up through an accumulation phase, you're probably not doing enough. If your strength is really declining, you're probably doing too much, and then see how that works out. For bodybuilding and from a coaching perspective, it's also, you know, there's more qualitative things I could say. How are your pumps? How do you feel? You know, if you like are doing so much chest work that you don't get a pump anymore, like I knew, I talked to a kid who was like, yeah, and this is actually intra-workout MRV. He's like, we always get on him for working out too much. And he was like, yeah, because we see him, like Nick Shaw and I, the co-founder of RP, we'd be in the gym, we'd start working out when he was already training, and we were powerlifting at the time. Our workouts would take an hour and a half, and we'd leave, and he'd still be training one body part at a time. And I'm talking about, like, muscle, like the chest. And he'd say, you know, I start training, and then eventually I get a pump, and then I keep training, and the pump goes away. And I'm like, Oh my God. Like, I've never literally trained a muscle enough to the pump goes away mid workout. I'm like, fuck. We're like, stop doing that. And he's like, I don't know, man. You got to do what it takes. And we're like, you're fucking insane. So, you know, you watch for those subjective factors. If you're feeling good, strong, but plenty beat up, I think you're on the right track. And here's another thing I'll say about MRV. Your MRV is not anybody fucking else's MRV. Me personally, my hamstrings, any more than about 10 sets a week, and they're fucked. That's like fucking nothing. I know people that can double that and be just fine. For me, that's all I can recover from. If I do any more than that, they start to actually have benign fasciculations, which is like when I'm trying to go to sleep and I move my hamstring, it just and then it just does that. I'm like, ugh, that's not good. And then strength falls off really shortly thereafter if I keep trying to do it. I start to pull my hamstrings, like scar tissue adhesions start to come up and get really fucked up in training. So, you know, if someone says like, hey, I don't think you're training this and that enough, find out your proper response, where you respond the best, where you're recovering the best, no more, no less, and stick around that region. Every now and again, you have to find out if it's changing, because it will, and under different conditions, it'll change. But don't let people say to you, oh, you should be training this much less, or you should be training it much more. It comes down to, and there's like Eric said earlier, there's your three standard deviations out, it's tons of individual difference. Some people can recover from, and I've seen the 30 working sets per muscle group per week. They're out there. A lot of times they don't actually grow much because they're very slow twitch dominant individuals. Their fatigue resistance and recovery is outside of the realm of possibility, but they don't make really great muscular adaptations because they've got the wrong fiber type for that. And then again, there's some people, oftentimes really gifted ones, oftentimes very fast twitch people, that are 6 or 8 sets a week for some body parts, and they just fucking go completely out of control. So always pay attention to your own recovery. If you're maintaining that performance within a mesocycle and then deloading, I think that's the best way to go about it. Start at 15, see if you can work your way up to 20, and that's all I got on the subject. As usually excessively verbose.
And then there was a question just about specific body parts on my Facebook. So are there certain general rules for, like, say the back might need more than...
I mean, I could search my Facebook feed. I have all those posts. Just Mike Israetel bodybuilding recommendations. I have everything by body part. Way more detail than I can ever answer on here. But I will say it's different for different body parts and different people. So, for example, some folks will have really fast twitch triceps that are really big and strong. They accumulate fatigue like crazy, and they have lower recoverable volumes than, say, somebody's biceps. Like in my case, my biceps aren't very impressive. They don't go very much. They're pretty slow twitch, I think, from their characteristics. And they can do a ton of work and nothing really ever happens. So I think it's different. I will say that lower back, spinal erectors, hamstrings generally tend to have lower MRVs in most individuals than muscles of the upper body, especially like the medial delts, rear delts, biceps. I think most people, if you ever try to do the same number of hard sets for your hamstrings or erectors, like deadlifting, that you do for your biceps, you're going to kill yourself. And if it's the other way around, you're just not going to grow much.
I think a lot of it as well is how easy it is to get that muscle into like a pretty stretched position. And I think this is one of the things that kind of comes into play with the hamstrings. So, you know, like with the biceps, like if you're going all the way down on a curl, that's still probably not in range of motion for your biceps. And so, you know, like you're still pumping out reps, but you're also probably not causing, as many micro tears, as much muscle damage, just from loading that muscle in a stretch position. Whereas, like, you know, if you're doing good RDLs and you're taken to an end range of motion, you're probably causing quite a bit more damage per rep in your hamstrings than you would in your biceps. So I think a lot of it, I think a lot of it revolves around that. Like a lot of people just report handling a lot more volume with, say, like their delts. Like, your delts are never in a stretch position. So I think...
And it's impossible to get them in a stretch position unless you want to sublux something or something.
Exactly. Like, and so like, on a per rep, per set basis, you're just simply not causing as much stress to your delts as you probably would be your hamstrings. So,
and muscle architecture plays into that role as well. Some muscles are parallel the fibers versus other arrangements of fibers can expose themselves to much greater per fiber stresses and things like that. It ends up being a really complicated answer. There's not really any really cool short answer, and I think individual variation plays greatly into that as well.
I think that we've pretty much covered everything. I'm not sure if the rest period thing was something I got asked a lot. Is it worthwhile to, you know, cram the volume in, or should you rest more, and where the literature stands on that? I know there was one paper that I think it was Brad who did it. It was you, was it, Eric? Regardless.
No, that was Mino and Brad, and Brad also did a follow-up training study. The thing with rest periods is, at best, by shortening your rest periods, aside from practical reasons of I don't have enough time to get all my volume in my schedule, which is extremely valid, and most people, that will be a concern if they're an adult, and I like an adult with an adult life, you know.
an important distinction.
Like, yes, very true. Not like someone like me who just gets online and screws around. No, but no. So yeah, outside of practical concerns, I would say that resting as long as you need to fully recover, which is different for different movements. Obviously, a lateral raise is only going to take like a minute and a half to fully recover on. But if you're doing a set of five at a 9 RPE on squats, that might take 5 minutes, 6 minutes, 7 minutes, even depending on your conditioning level. I think for the most part, you want to rest that long. I don't think we should be chasing, you know, metabolic fatigue from short rest intervals. I think for the most part, and this is probably something Brad would disagree with, Schoenfeld, that mechanical tension and progressive tension overload is the dominating factor in hypertrophy stimulation. And I think the effect of like metabolite accumulation is at best makes up for some of the silly things that I see lifters do. You know, like, okay, you're not going to rest. Well, it's going to indirectly create some stimulus there, but there will be less mechanical tension. And, you know, we've seen stuff like where if you take very low loads and do EMG work with it compared to high loads, even if you go to failure, you don't get the same kind of EMG. So, I mean, there are some issues with some of the things that I see promoted towards very light load training. And I don't think it's going to be a huge difference in terms of hypertrophy, but I would say that based on some of the meta-analyses, there tends to be a slight favoring of not really light loads, and there are issues with dropping your total volume or dropping the load you can use by resting too short or going to failure, doing things like that are typically associated with metabolic fatigue.
I just want to say two things about that. One, I think we have a slight disagreement about interpretation of the literature, just kind of from a what is true standpoint. I do think things kind of lean towards that as long as you're equating the number of sets, most people seem to be able to grow fairly well or just as well with quite a bit lighter loads. But I would also say, and I think we would agree with this, kind of from a practical perspective, that just doesn't happen in the real world. Like in the study that Brad did on that, his 25 to 35 rep max group grew just as much as his 8 to 12 rep max group, even in trained people. But also multiple people like got sick and vomited in the 25 to 35 rep max group. So I think maybe if you could equate the number of sets you were doing, you would grow similarly. But in the real world, no one fucking does that. Like you're not going to knock out 5 sets of 30 squats that are hard. Like that's stupid. Like that's so hard. Like most people just wouldn't do it, and there's no point for them to do it. But the biggest thing I wanted to say, and I need to drop this in here, otherwise Andrew Vygotsky may never talk to me again. Regarding EMG and muscle activation with high loads versus heavier loads,
I know it's coming.
Okay, yeah, that doesn't necessarily mean that motor unit recruitment across the course of the set isn't the same with heavier and light loads, because EMG, that's only telling you the electrical activity at any given point in time. So when you take into account decreases in activation threshold and motor unit cycling, you very well could get full recruitment across the course of a fatiguing set with much, much lighter loads. So I don't know that would factor in all that much to the consideration, but I think to a degree that's somewhat navel-gazing, because I don't think anyone here is recommending people focus most of their training on very, very light loads, very, very high reps. I just kind of wanted to toss those two things in as clarifications.
I would agree with that. And I think also you're hitting failure for different reasons when you do a very high rep set versus a low rep set. I mean, you literally can't move the load anymore when you're doing heavy work. But then you're having to deal with some subjective stuff for high rep things because your pain tolerance comes into it, which may or may not be accurately representing how close you are to true failure in the different ways it's defined. So anyway, I guess that might have been a little bit of a straw man with EMG. given. I knew that, but I think there are issues with focusing too much on the fatigue side of it, and we should primarily be chasing performance, even if the goal is hypertrophy.
I agree with that wholeheartedly.
Mike, you can go ahead.
Thanks. Yeah, I'm been facing this. You know, every good idea gets taken out of its characteristic zone of application, or its proper zone. I think that's been happening with metabolite training lately. The super high reps taken to failure. I think for a number of reasons, and what I like to do in my reasoning is take from various other sources of information that haven't been directly studied, but very confidently studied in one area, and kind of put them into another and say, what could you reasonably expect? And I think that metabolite training, because it is unbelievably fatiguing, because it probably leads to some fiber type conversion in the short term, and for a number of other reasons, is probably not a sustainable way to consistently arrange your training. I think metabolite training has been very favorably received in the short-term studies because they're short-term studies. I've personally tried metabolite training for extensive periods of time. What ends up happening is the awesome pumps, the awesome delayed onset muscle soreness, which is by very characteristic of metabolite training, goes away within a couple of weeks, and you just end up pumping out rest sets and reps. You don't feel a fucking thing. Nothing's happening because you get really, really good at clearing metabolites, and it just don't get the same effects anymore. And you keep doing that, and you start to feel very overreached because the fatigue effect is massive from metabolite training. It's not a sustainable way to train. I think it's good for when you've been putting in the hard meat and potatoes work of heavy lifting, which is really a volume loads summed up over heavy sets, anywhere conservatively in the 6 to 15 rep range, where I think most training should occur. And that's progressing through that, through strength, getting stronger in those rep ranges is the best by proxy way of stimulating long-term hypertrophy. Every now and again, you're going to want to use metabolites as a cool trick, but that trick fades away fucking fast. And after about a mesocycle of that, you want to go low volume phase to resensitize yourself to volume, and then back up the ladder you go. If there's anyone listening to this who thinks there's a way around doing sets of 10 or so in the squat, bench press, deadlift, pull-up, bent row to be really jacked, there's not. If you want big legs, what do? You squat 500 for 10. You want huge legs, what do? Fundamentally, you have to inch your way towards 585 for 10. I'm sorry I have to be the bearer of bad news. Ain't no fucking tricks. For a month or two, you can trick your muscles around and do high reps, drop sets, all that bullshit. I've done it. I regularly do it. Regularly doesn't mean always. Periodically, but you get really used to that. That trick only lasts for a certain amount of time. So I very much share Eric's skepticism over the long-term application of those types of training methods. And I think, you know, where are these people that only lift 135 in the bench and have big Rami-sized pecs? They don't exist. And if we take reduction ad absurdum and say, well, you know, 40 reps to failure still gets you the same hypertrophy, I can reduce that way to absurdity. In really untrained populations, running protocols, jogging protocols lead to measurable, impressive quadricep hypertrophy. Why? Because these people are so fucking untrained. Everything gets fucked up when they run. That shit won't last. Pretty soon, you keep running, you're not going to see any hypertrophy. And pretty soon after that, you're going to see some atrophy of type 2 fibers, and you're not going to get jacked running. The only way to get jacked in the long term is sets of anywhere, I think, 5 to 15 reps and getting stronger in that rep range. That should be the meat and potatoes of your training, from a coaching perspective and reading the literature.
You know, I think it's funny. One of the videos that's really, really popular in bodybuilding circles is that Kai Green video where he's like, I'm a bodybuilder, I'm not a powerlifter, it's about feeling the weight, blah, blah, blah. In that exact same fucking video, he benches like 500
for eight. Like 5 reps or something.
It's like, yeah, like you're not a powerlifter, but you still got really strong in the process. Like, I think you're kind of shooting your own argument in the foot with this one.
Agreed.
Yeah, I totally agree. The only thing I'm not convinced of just yet is that there is a need or a benefit to including really high rep. I would call it metabolic or fatigue focused training. I wouldn't say metabolite training, because in my brain I actually envision you trying to train the actual metabolites, like get those hydrogen ions in the squat rack kind of thing.
They have potential.
They do. But I don't know. That to me, I think it's theoretically maybe there's a benefit for hypertrophying slow twitch fibers that wouldn't get, they'd get recruited, but they wouldn't get trained from heavy work, maybe.
I think the same thing occurs for faster twitch fibers for metabolite training. I would bet some money that fast twitch, really, really fast twitch fibers are used during metabolite training, but the forces are not sufficiently high to ever really challenge them. I think it's been very clear. There is actually mechanistic evidence of literal force receptors in muscle fibers that detect force and trigger hypertrophy. I think in fast twitch fibers, they, if their force is not sufficiently high, they can be on, especially towards the end of a movement, and on does not, you know, I go like this. There's no hypertrophy of my forearm. The forces, the resistance is not, I can do this for forever. Nothing happened. Well, I just made a little funny joke there. I can do this for forever. It really only takes 30 seconds. Am I right, fellas? Oh, all right. But in any case, yeah, there's a difference between, it takes longer. There's a difference between utilizing a system or a muscle or a fiber type and reaching overload with it. And I think I would bet that with really crazy high weights and going to failure, fast twitch fibers, oh, they turn on, but I don't think they're mechanically damaged enough or sense enough force to really hypertrophy much. And just the same way, I think slow twitch fibers hypertrophy to some extent from really heavy weights, but maybe the hypertrophy better from lighter weights. But then again, hey, fast twitch fibers hypertrophy 2 times more than slow twitch fibers. So by definition, your training should be biased heavy anyway, unless you're all slow twitch or something. And then you're fucked anyway. Go do endurance sport. Fuck.
Yeah, I guess the only thing I would say there, Mike, would be I just want to clarify, I suppose, that what you're not saying is that it has to be the squat, bench, and deadlift to get that volume in. For example, the leg press or dumbbell press or what have you could be viable alternatives. Or do you actually think that you mentioned the squat and the bench press, that those are movements that anyone who cares about hypertrophy, you have to have those in there?
I think you should give it an old college try. I think movements can be ranked for most people on average overload and disruptiveness to physiological systems. I think that what you can get out of squatting on average for hypertrophy of the lower body is more than what you can get out of leg pressing. If you cannot squat for some reason, and it better be a goddamn good one, then can you lose leg press? Yes. Are we really going to sit here and say that you can get the same thing out of some kind of Nautilus chest machine as you can from a bench press? Anyone who really thinks that, what they need to do, go bench press for sets of 10 close to failure, do strict deep flies, and then go train again on machines and try to replicate that workout. The degree of delayed onset muscle soreness is going to be completely different, perhaps non-existent on the machines. I've tried this numerous times. Many machines, especially more poorly designed ones, seem for a number of reasons I can't isolate to not disrupt homeostasis nearly as much. I think compound heavy basics are the way to go to form the core of a program. If you have poor mechanical design in your body for that, if you have injury concerns, those are all good things. But I think you're by definition taking that second place position in the effect. I do think squatting, benching, deadlifting, overhead pressing, pull-ups, bent rows are the best core designs for programming. I think the biggest people in the world have used almost all of those. And some of them have used some machines and some have not. I don't think you can just replace a leg press with a squat. I just don't think it'll grow your legs the same way.
Yeah, I think that perhaps you could fill in the gaps, like say a leg press and then a lower back extension, barbell hip thrust, something like that to get, or RDL, for example, to get the hamstrings or whatever. But
I don't think it'll be the same. I think if you have to fill in the gaps, you should. But I think if you don't have to, you should look to the hardcore movements first.
I have less confidence than Mike in that, but if you've ever seen my programming or what I write about, I typically emphasize the big free compound weights. I also don't think there's going to be a huge difference between someone who wants to front squat versus back squat, unless they just have a lever that always makes them dump it forward when they get heavy. Or I think only through injury with high level athletes have I seen pretty good have I learned that maybe that's just kind of a construct we believe, you know. And it's coming from a powerlifter, so I'm definitely biased towards the big three. But I've had some bodybuilders who previously did, you know, squats and deadlifts, they get hurt, and now all they do is hip thrust and weighted back extensions and like occluded work, and actually not just maintain their muscle, but even progress. So am I going to be able to, you know, measure whether they're progressing faster than they were before? No, but if you're progressing, it makes me think you can probably still get to your potential. So I think there's many ways to run with hypertrophy. And I think, yeah, there are probably some exercises that are better suited for it, but I wouldn't say it's like Ten Commandments level of stuff for me.
Three commandments. Squat, bench, deadlift.
Three. Yeah, I like it. So I'd
love to chat more about powerlifting for bodybuilding, so maybe we can do that in another show or at another time. For now, I'm going to wrap it up with just one last question, just because I got asked it like four or five times, and that is how your volume requirements change when you're in a deficit versus when you're in a caloric surplus. So whoever wants to take this away can go ahead. Eric, you're the man.
I want this one so bad because I get frustrated by this question. They don't change. Your ability to recover changes, right? So you are never deficit and a surplus. It's not an on and off switch. It is not. If like right now, I'm not in a deficit per definition of what we use on the internet, right? But I just got up. It's only 9 something, or it's 10 a.m. now. I just slept for 8 hours. I had like a freaking protein bar, and that's it. I'm right now. I'm in a deficit. So it's the summation of acute time periods of deficits and surpluses that define whether or not you gain or lose weight. You can gain muscle while you're in a sustained deficit over time, although it's obviously not as efficient, harder if you get more experience, et cetera, depends on how much body fat you have to liberate as additional energy. So what that means is that the volume you need to do to grow, if you are trying to grow in a deficit, that's already kind of you're doing it wrong kind of thing, unless you're just really, really overweight and you're like, you know what, I've got to lose weight regardless. I'm going to be in a deficit for a couple years. Is not different. So it doesn't change the rules. However, it changes your ability to recover. So you have to do more. You have to pay more attention to the fatigue management side of the equation. So autoregulation, deloads, all these things become important. And there may very well become a point where, I guess as Mike would put it, your MRV comes down because you just simply can't recover from it. And that is why you can't grow as effectively in a deficit, because you can't train effectively. And there's also some physiological reasons, you know, all kinds of changes that happen in your body when you get really, really, really lean and glycogen depleted and fat store depleted. So the way I think in a practical sense this should look is that for the most part, your training should be roughly the same. Let's say for a contest prep, I think that's probably where I think it matters the most. Let's say you're dieting for 6 to 8 months. For, let's say, the first fifth of that time period, and say a couple months maybe, your volume probably wouldn't change much. And then from there, you might have to start backing off. And it's very important to pay attention to markers for fatigue, overreaching, stress, both psychologically and physiologically. But if you're doing like a 4-week mini cut, or if you're doing, you know, like a 2-week just watching your diet because you're, you know, 94 kg and you need to make the 93 kg weight class in 2 weeks, it doesn't really affect your training, in my opinion. Or shouldn't.
Awesome, Eric. So if everyone's in agreement, then we can move on and wrap it up.
Agreed.
Awesome. Okay. And I think this was a really productive conversation, guys. I know that I learned a lot, and there was a lot of clarification. And I know a lot of people have been requesting a conversation between these two camps. And I think we found a lot of common ground. And if we do disagree, it's the stuff that's sort of more in the weeds. With that, I will conclude. Eric, did you have one thing to say?
Yeah, I have one random thing that I totally forgot about because you said camps and it reminded me.
Yeah.
Earlier, Mike, I think you said you apologized if you offended me by characterizing minimum effective dose. I just want to put it out there. I don't think I've ever promoted minimum effective dose, so you definitely did not offend me. And I would not categorize myself as someone who promotes the minimum effective dose. I am, in the end, a bodybuilding and powerlifting coach, so I'm trying to get people to be insanely jacked and huge regardless.
This isn't how fights work, guys. Come on.
I know. You're better than this. I mean, minimum effective dose is the best, and you guys are dumb.
Fuck you!
You know, no, fuck you. There we go. Okay.
I submit the following argument. Fuck you, period. Response.
Excellent. I can't even argue with that. I said the same thing.
So. Well, gentlemen, it's been a pleasure. I want to thank you so much for your time. For all of our listeners, I'm going to have everyone's information, including their websites where you can find them and their social media, in the description box. Don't forget to hit the subscribe button if you're watching this on YouTube. Same goes for iTunes and Stitcher. We will see you guys in the next episode.
Anything that will annoy me, you'll pick up on it.
Exactly. It's one of my small pleasures in life.
You do have a small pleasure, it's true.
I your number may be larger, but my effect size is much bigger, so.